say that this is not a concert. I'm just playing on the streets. So if you can't hear, I'm sorry, but we didn't bring a big PA system because we didn't want it to be a concert. I'm just hit back here giving to the people who've been so great to me.
Come and gone since I wandered from my home in those Oklahoma hills where I come from. Many pages of my life have turned, many lessons I have learned, and I feel like in those hills where I come from. Way down yonder on the Indian Nation, right by pony on the reservation in the Oklahoma hills where I come from. Way down yonder on the Indian Nation, cowboy's life is my occupation in the Oklahoma hills where I come from.
The crew of people that I had with me basically were two young musicians, one that played accordion and one that played a violin. Harry Sandler had been my road manager for years. I needed him to help organize where we were going to play and getting this small crew. There was no road crew. There was no roadies. I think a couple times we had some volunteer roadies that kind of showed up and said that they would help.
Well, in my time of dying.
Tracy was my security guard back then, and he was also my cousin. It was really kind of a hippie thing to do, you know. It reminded me of what I had seen happen in Washington Square, you know, during the 60s, when, you know, people would play in Washington Square and people would sit around like, it was a folk thing, you know.
Jesus gonna make him a diamond.
I had my little accordion, and Merritt had her fiddle. John had his two acoustic guitars, some Gibson Doves. It was really raw and stripped down, is to say the least.
Well, meet me, Jesus, meet me. Meet me in the air.
My whole involvement with this tour started with a completely cold phone call. It literally just rang. I picked up and I was already hired. Mike and I had dated, broken up, and he put me up for the tour because they needed a violin player. Like at the last second, they were leaving in, I think, 2 weeks. They needed someone and he said, call Merritt. She'll be psyched to do it. I'm sure she'll be into it. And they call me and they say, would you like to go on a summer tour with John Mellencamp? We're leaving soon. I was shocked, and then I quit my job, and we were off and running.
Well, 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 so I can die easy. Jesus gonna make up my dying bed.
But the rustler.
The idea from the tour became to light. And it was a vague notion on what Woody Guthrie had done when he would go play in the fields for the workers in California.
A battle to fight. She rose from her blanket with a gun in each hand. Said, come all up.
Throw the word art around very loosely these days. This guy's an artist. Matter of fact, there's even a fellow who calls himself the artist.
The artist.
Right? I think that that word should be used very sparingly. And, you know, Bob Dylan was an artist. He changed the world. He did. Picasso changed the world. guys like me and probably the artist, I'm happy to say, and I'm proud to be a part of a musical community, and that's what I do. But I am not an artist.
From the track to the track, and the beat pound in his brain, and he taught how to walk in a pack, shoot in the back with fist in a clip, to hang in two lips, with his head beneath a hood.
Inspired by Woody Guthrie and Bob Dylan, John set out to thank the marginalized working class the best way he knew how, with music. With a spike in homelessness and unemployment, being able to afford a concert ticket became a luxury for many. Very few hit songs were played. He just played songs he loved for the people that he cared most about.
I don't think corporate America does not have my best interests at heart. They are the power. They are the power. Get the starving people and the people who need mental health off the streets of New York. You want to do something with the money? Get those people off the streets. Take them, help them. What means something to me is trying to help these people. If you take that money and put it on and give it to the street people and build institutions and build shelters for the blacks, for the poor, the Hispanic, then you're doing something, man. Then it means something. Then I'll be there yelling for you.
I guess the danger in you saying this is somebody sitting back watching this saying, okay, you're kind of like a one-man corporation now. Do your part.
I did my part. I do my part every day.
Some kind of way out of here. Should a joker to thief. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessman and drink my wine. Plowman dig my earth. Nobody of it along the line. Nobody of it is worth.
Surrounded by buildings that are milestones to North American industrial might, the area echoes financial stability. General Motors is here. They are completing their $500 million world headquarters in the Renaissance Center. Welcome to Detroit.
But in Detroit, they were pissed off. We played in Detroit, where Jimmy Hoffa used to make his union speeches, which is right downtown. Now, this is the year 2000, and Detroit was just starting to go broke. And they told Harry if we played that they were going to arrest us, and we said, you know, we're going to play.
With a crumbling infrastructure in a city whose primary source of income came from the automotive industry, evictions and layoffs started to take its toll on the blue-collared factory workers of Detroit. Many who spent generations working for the same corporations, now out of work and finding their city filing for Chapter 9 bankruptcy.
But it does seem like Americans fall for that kind of stuff.
Well, you know why we fall for it? Because we're getting swindled. That's what it is. It's a swindle. When you change the truth, right, to gain, you know, to have your position known or to make money, if you and I had perpetrated a swindle such as has been done in the United States, we'd be in jail.
What swindle are you talking about?
Iraq.
You name it.
Right.
The war on drugs, the war on poverty, every swindle that they throw in front of us. And we go, yeah, man, that's right. But the reality is it's all about somebody else making money.
You're very patriotic. I mean, sometimes I listen to your songs and I think, wow, that guy is talking about an America I don't know about.
No, you don't. You don't know about it because you're not out there.
But what am I missing in the middle of the country?
You're missing people who are honest people. They believe what people tell them. They tell the truth. They think people are telling them the truth.
As an outspoken advocate for the working class in a city frustrated with unfair treatment, John's visit is met with tension and a strong police presence from government leadership. Even in the year 2020, a city plagued with bankruptcy, unemployment, and the Flint water crisis, just to name a few, showing progress is slow as we continue to have the same conversation decades later.
They were afraid that there would be a lot of white suburban kids and adults that would come in to listen to us playing, and he was afraid there'd be a race riot, which I thought was a ridiculous fucking point. There's not going to be a race riot. For what, you know, what reason?
The police arrived, and I don't know if they were trying to discourage this, but ultimately they didn't ask for it to be stopped. And ended up, there was a huge crowd by this point. There was thousands of people.
But tension in Detroit didn't happen overnight. Facing an unpopular war in Vietnam, redlining, record underemployment, and police brutality targeting minority communities, Detroit became a flashpoint for what would later be called an uprising, giving a cryptic glimpse into the struggle still being fought decades later for the same reasons.
In the white man's game.
When Bob wrote this song, the world was all wrong. It was just part of the play, the human disgrace that we spit in the face of all that I hid, with no direction to steer. Now the time is of our tears, and the time is now here. Excuses, the change is so slow, but this behavior must go, because we all are the same. Just the pigment of our skin is only paper thin, and who knows when to begin in the mess we live in. It's just saying a prayer that we do what we need to, and fuck all of those who keep us just a pawn in the white man's game.
A folk song is What's Wrong and How to Fix It. Or it could be Who's Hungry and Where Their Mouth Is. Or Who's Out of Work and Where the Job Is. Or Who's Broke and Where the Money Is. Or Who's Carrying a Gun and Where the Peace Is.
So we went ahead and played in Detroit, and the cops were there everywhere, because we, you know, in their mind, we were breaking the law. They kind of surrounded the whole perimeter of the concert. I mean, there were hundreds and hundreds of cops there, but they didn't arrest anybody, and us playing went on without any trouble. There wasn't any fights, there wasn't any race riot, there wasn't any other thing.
Well, a country boy named Shorty and a city boy named Dan had to prove who could run the fastest to whip this Lucy's hand.
With Annie had all the money, and he also had the looks. But Shorty must have had something more that can be found in books. Cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across. Well, that's what Miss Lucy said. Cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across. Well, it's you that I wanna win. Well, cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across. That's what Miss Lucy said. Cut across, Shorty, Shorty, cut across. Well, it's you that I wanna win.
You see, the real thing, not face to face with you, most people are pretty level-headed. They just said, well, this is the end. This is the end of the world. People ain't been living right. Human race ain't been treating each other right. Been robbing each other in different ways with fountain pens, guns, and having wars, and killing each other and shooting around somebody. Has robbed somebody. Some of us is about starved to death. Others spend $5,000 or $6,000 on a little party at night. Some lose $5,000 or $10,000 across a gambling table at night. Just nicely ain't been living right. So this dust storm is the end. And their conversation just run like that about the what is right and what is wrong, and that they kindly is wondering if they had done right all their life, and anyway they was hoping they had, because the time had come when the river was there to cross, and everybody said, well, so long, it's been good to know you, let her come.
With Detroit's show being a huge success, even with a massive police presence, John stayed out of jail and hit the road for Cleveland, Ohio. With the advent of the internet and easier access to mobile phones, speculation of his visits started to mount, preparing in a much different fashion than Detroit. City officials rolled out the red carpet for the small-town Samaritan visiting their big city as he thanks the great people of Cleveland, Ohio.
Born in a small town and live in a small town. Probably die in a small town. Oh, that small communities. All my friends, this is a small town. My parents live in the same small town. My job is a small town. Provides a little opportunity. Got nothing against a big town. Man, I'm so hazy enough, say, look who's in the big town. My bed is in a small town. Oh, and that's good enough for me. Well, I was born in a small town, and I can breathe in a small town. Probably die in a small town. Oh, that's probably where they bury me.
Well, I don't consider it work, you know. I mean, I'll get some of my best ideas behind a steering wheel rather than behind a guitar. I think it's all got to do with my idea of work. When I first started writing songs, that was my getaway from the world and from my job and everything. I'd go home and write a song. On a happy night,
man, gypsy Scott. We set off in a tour bus, using it as kind of the camper, but no planning ahead. So there really was limited opportunities of places to stay. Town to town, we were calling and looking on maps at the time to try to find campgrounds.
John had it so that we were unaware of what city we were going to the next day. Or if we had 2 days off in between, we still didn't know where we were going. I remember myself and Merritt, who was the fiddle player on the tour, you know, always kind of looking out the windows on the tour bus, trying to figure out what city we were going to by looking at the big green highway signs that said Philadelphia or Boston or Detroit. Chicago, all of these amazing places that we got to go play, and we would get excited and go like, I think we're going to Chicago, I think we're going to Philly, Boston, I think we're going to wherever it may be, and that's kind of how we figured it out. So it was really cool the way that he framed this tour.
I'd never done anything like this before. I'd played music for a long time, but I've never toured at this scale.
The impromptu tour was now totally out of control. No longer a simple impromptu concert in a park, they would soon discover that it had taken on a life of its own.
And then every place we go would get bigger. And people started to find out that the tour was happening, and somehow people would figure out what city we were going to or where we were going to be. Or every time we'd show up, the crowd would be a little bigger and a little more ready for it.
In this little area, there was like a little gathering, and I thought, yes, that's the spot. We should go over there. Something interesting is happening there. So I walked over, I said, what's happening? Someone turned to me, they said, yes, have you heard? John Mellencamp's gonna play here. And I thought, huh, who knew? Nobody knew that. I guess he is now. I remember running back and thinking, like, oh, this is really funny.
There were some people who would following us. You know, we would stop at a truck stop to get gas. There were people who were trailing the tour bus. They would ask, where are you going? What city are you going to? And that was really amazing.
It was kind of in the early days of everyone having cell phones. You had this, for the first time, in a widespread way, people could call their friend really fast and say, get down here right now. And then that person could come down and they could alert each other.
People would, in the trailer park, would realize that we were parked there. And then as time went on, the trailer park thought it was going to be the place that we performed. And people started showing up at these different trailer parks. You know, some would be, you know, by lakes or, and then they would be right out of town. And then they would ask me where we're gonna go next. And I would say the same thing. I've never planned anything in my life, so I don't really know.
I didn't think a, you know, musical artist at the level that John was at would be able to pull this off without some kind of pandemonium going on. Which, interestingly enough, there was total pandemonium, but in a really interesting way.
And until the end, it was just mayhem.
And now the radio stations were having contests, you know, like Find Elmo or whatever the hell that is. They were having contests to find John Mellencamp. So this thing had ballooned way, way different than we anticipated.
Has anybody seen John Mellencamp? Anybody, hands up. Nobody? You saw him? Where? Last we heard, he had left the hotel and was driving around looking for a place to play. Everybody told everybody it's going to be here. But what I've got right now is the radio station on the phone. In case John's punching around monitoring the stations, let's let him know this is the place to play real quick, all right? You hear that, Johnny? Your people are here waiting for you, brother. Market Square, downtown Pittsburgh.
So I anticipated, you know, 200 or 300 people showing up, just going, oh, look, there's John Mellencamp playing on the streets. Because of the radio stations and the record companies all getting involved, by the time we got to Chicago, there was 30,000 people.
Get him out of here! We wait all day and time!
Chicago is my hometown, and so I had an added excitement about playing there. And to have that stop be this blowout of the whole tour, the sort of culmination of all these things, and have it be Daily Plaza, just wall-to-wall people, was really wild. You know, we're in this place I've been 1,000 times and walked through it. Never in a million years did I think that I would end up in Daily Plaza standing next to John Mellencamp. And he gave me the first verse of Pink Houses to sing. And it was, it really meant a lot to me. It was really one for the books.
There's a black man with a black hat, living in a black neighborhood. He's got interstate running through his front yard. He's got it so good. There's a woman in the kitchen, eating up the evening star. He looks at her and says, I remember when you could stop a car. Oh, but ain't that America, you and me? Ain't that America, something to see, baby?
In a t-shirt, listen to a rock and roll station. He's got a greasy hair and a sleazy smile. Says, Lord, this must be my destination. Of course, don't wait. When I was younger, they said, boy, you're gonna be president. Just like everything else, those old crazy dreams kind of came and went. Oh, but ain't that America for you and me? Ain't that America with something to see, babe? Ain't that America, home of the free? Yeah, little pink houses for you.
Thank you for supporting us for 25 years. Thank you very much, Chicago. Thank you.
This celebrity status, you really don't like it much, do you?
Oh, it's the biggest bunch of bullshit. I don't really see the purpose of it. I mean, you know, there are great things that have happened because of it, but I mean, I'm just some guy from Seymour, Indiana, who happened to have a couple hit records, and that's just about the long and short of it.
What kind of responsibility, then, do you feel you have as a public figure?
Well, I feel like I shouldn't have any, but the reality is that I do, even though I don't want it. And I've always been kind of weird about that, because I never really wanted to I didn't make records to be responsible to anyone.
Talk a little bit about this. You talked about giving back to the fans, that sort of thing. We spoke with folks out there. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, the whole thing just started out to be, you know, the first one we did was in Philadelphia. We didn't even tell anybody. We just went to downtown Philadelphia. Well, I have to be honest, and, you know, when it first started out, it was really fun. But this is like the 10th one, and it's going to take me a lot of responsibilities. Job. God damn, we don't want a job. I lasted 25 years without a job. I don't want one now. Thanks a lot, you guys.
Thank you.
I'll buy you a drink tonight.
Usually these settings, especially for an artist at the level that John is at, you don't have that kind of freedom. You know, you're going into an arena or stadium and pretty kind of strict set list or, you know, lighting, monitors, tickets, seating, all of that. And this was just, like I said, we just felt like we were street artists just going and just picking up some instruments and playing. And that really was the fuel for the energy of this Good Samaritan tour.
For him to have maybe some freedom, just to reconnect with some of the things he loved about being a musician. And I think professional musicians so often get disconnected with their passion and their love because it becomes a job and there are expectations and you have to meet those. Like, you are obligated to, you know, perform to a level that requires you to work. This kind of idea brought all of the musicians back to, you know, what they really loved.
I think this tour was unique for John and special because he was really stepping outside of what people expect of him and doing what he wanted to do completely and, like, bring it right back to that very immediate connection between artist and audience, just right there. I think he played his favorite songs that he weren't his, that he just loved, and he didn't charge any money. He just funded it himself because he loves making music.
On violin from Chicago, Merritt Lear. From Bloomington, Indiana, Mike Flynn playing accordion.
Now believe I've lost my way. Charlotte's there in Albany and Billy's there in Suede. And there's money in their pockets, all the dues are paid. Well, there's wine on every table and there's food on every plate. Well, I hope I get there pretty soon before it gets too late. Well, I ran on down the road a while to the other side of town. My clothes were getting wrinkled and my socks were falling down. But I could not stop to pull them up in fear that I'd be late. So I kept on running down the road until I saw the gate. Well, I was a early bird of faith, glowing golden like the sun. Everybody kept on singing, saying, come on, we're just begun. Well, I ran right in and I sat right down. I ordered up some wine. The talk was fast and clever, and the women all were fine. Well, Charlotte asked me where I'd been with jaded ivory eyes. And I told her I'd been hung up with some bigger in disguise. Well, she laughed like temple bells, kissed me on the cheek and said, you know it's hard to be alive sometimes, but it's easy to be dead.
Well, you know, if we want a better world, then it starts at home. It starts with one person. Everybody has to be a better person, and that's the way it starts.